So, are you ready for the word? Are you ready for the word? Are you ready for the word? Then let's get right into it. Turn to Proverbs chapter 25, verse 2. Proverbs chapter 25, verse 2. And by the way, do I have any first-time visitors in the room, first-time guests? Just wave at me. God bless you, family. God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you guys. Amen. Anybody else? Amen. Listen, please come back and see Pastor Joe. He's incredible. Praise the Lord. Amen. Come back and see Pastor Joe. He's just amazing. And I can tell by the group that's here how great God has blessed him. And so let's get right into the word, and I believe it's going to bless you this morning. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 25, verse 2, it is God's privilege to conceal things and the king's privilege to discover them. It is God's privilege to conceal things and the king's privilege to discover them. I'm going to talk to you real quick on a message that's called The Third Row. And there's a subtopic, but I'm going to give you the subtopic later on. It's called The Third Row. Can you say The Third Row? Holy Spirit, you teach because you're better than I am at this whole thing. And so we bless you, we honor, we give you praise that this word will inspire faith in your people, God, and they will leave more encouraged than they ever have. We love you. We bless you for Pastor Joe and Miss Ashley as they're traveling. Lord God, I thank you for them. I thank you, Lord God, for their safe return and that they will have a wonderful time. In Jesus' name we pray. Let everybody say amen, amen. And amen. How many of you have heard the saying, the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed, and the New Testament is like the Old Testament revealed, right? Any old school church people in the house, right? That literally means, in my opinion, that with God, there are hidden treasures. You know, sometimes what God does is he likes to conceal or hide his truths in different types of patterns or prophetic cycles throughout the Bible, Old Testament and New. And Solomon said this. He says, it's up to us to seek out those things, explore or figure out what God wants to reveal to us through his word. As a matter of fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1, and I apologize to the team, I gave you verse 4, but verse 1, it says, let a man regard us, the servants of Christ, as stewards of the mysteries of God. Let us be stewards of the mysteries of God. That word steward means that God has entrusted us with his secret things, watch this, to distribute, oversee, and take care of those things. It's a spiritual blessing to be or to have access to the mysteries of God. It's a spiritual blessing to be a person that receives revelation from God. Amen? It says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 9, according to his good pleasure, God makes known his mysteries, his revelation to us. According to his good pleasure, God makes known his revelation to us. And as stewards, guess what? We are to communicate the secret things of God to other people. And today, I'm going to share with you one of those mysteries, one of those theological treasures that has been discovered, a revelation that everybody who knows Jesus should know. Everybody who knows Jesus should know. And I'm going to ask you to act like you didn't look inside of the pamphlet that's on there, because some of y'all already looked and peeked, and y'all probably think you know the secret. Amen. And we're going to keep preaching. Amen. So let me preface it this way. In 2014, my late father-in-law, he wrote a book called The Third Row. And in it is one of the most powerful revelations. And today I have the honor of sharing it with you. I believe the Lord has put in my heart. He said, Pat, yes, Dad has gone on to be with the Lord, and he's in heaven with me, but I need this revelation to be shared throughout the world, so I can't let this revelation die. And when I was invited to come to Fountain of Life, I always ask the Lord, God, is there something in particular that you want me to say to your people? And I just literally, I can't make this up. I kept hearing the third row, the third row, the third row, and I pray that it's going to inspire you today. How many of you could use some encouragement right now? Yeah, like we all can use some inspiration, especially in the time and the world that we're living in. And so to make sense of it, let me first share with you a little story from my pre-pastoral days. So that way you can sort of get the gist of what we're going to talk about today. And you'll know why I said pre-pastoral when I share this story with you. But before I do I have any fashion people in the room? Yeah, like I literally had like one. Nobody raised their hand. None of y'all are fashion people? Like, I had one person who came to me, and he was like, dude, like, that suit with those shoes, it's on point. And I'm like, thank you, man, so much. I got to keep up with the young people. I know what that guy is, but he was kind of pretty. He's like a pretty-looking guy, and I wish I want to point him out because he's like a supermodel. Where's he at? Where's that guy at? He didn't stay? Huh? Oh, that's you right there? He's like, I'll be the supermodel. He's like... Yeah, that's him, right? He didn't want to say nothing. Face all red, the face, the color of his shirt. Come on, that little supermodel guy right there. I was like, you look better than I do, sir. What are you talking about? Amen. Listen, I'm talking about fashion people. Those of you, watch this. Those of you that have your original shoes in their original boxes in your closet, maybe your hats are hanging neatly or they're placed in a section of your closet. Those of you that have your shirts neatly hanging in the closet and maybe they're hanging with all the buttons, they're facing the same way. Or maybe you have like your suits color-coded in your closet and they're all, y'all looking around like whoever that is, they need Jesus. or instead of sending your clothes to the dry clean, instead of sending your clothes to the washer and dryer, you like to send your clothes to the dry cleaner. Yeah, anybody like that? Your pants are neatly folded up in the closet, like department store stack in your, in, no? None of you? I guess I'm, well, me neither. I just want to know who I need to throw some oil on. But the thing about me is, yes, I love my clothes. I take care of my clothes. I work hard for my clothes. Don't bleach my clothes. Don't break my buttons. Don't wrinkle or mishandle my garments. And I'm not talking about anybody in particular. All I'm saying is I love my clothes. And I remember one day when I was back in San Antonio, it's where I'm from. I was working at a high-end, big and tall store that has all these name brands. You'd probably know it today as DXL, but before DXL, it was called something else. And when I came home from work one day, I was welcomed in the living room by my friends and family, and they were getting ready to go to a nightclub, right? And I walk in the living room, and I acknowledge them all, but I noticed that my brother, I have two brothers, I have a middle brother and I have a younger brother, and I brought pictures of my brother. I'm sorry I didn't bring a picture of my family, but those are my brothers, you know, so you can see me right there, the big chubby looking one. I mean, and then in the middle, that's my little brother. He thinks he's tough, but he's not. His name is Johnny, and then next to that guy is our behemoth of a brother. His name is Danny, and Danny's like 6'6". At the time when this story took place, he was about 6'6", probably about 220 pounds at that time. So I got to look up at Danny, right? So anyway, I walk in the living room. I see Danny's got this shirt on, and this shirt is a nice Ralph Lauren designer shirt, which I know Danny don't have a job, so Danny can't pay for. And I walk in, and I'm like, that looks like the shirt that I worked really hard for and that I bought with my own money. It's like the one shirt that I really, really, really wanted to wear, like that special shirt. And he's got it on. And so I'm like, I'm not going to say anything to him because he very well could have got some money and bought him a shirt. So I go in my room, and I looked in my closet, and I looked at my department store stack, brand new shirts on top of the closet right next to my jeans that are stacked and folded right next to the closet. And the shirts are hanging up, and they're all buttons are going the same way. And I'm looking, and I notice that shirt is missing. And here's what this guy, he's not the smartest one out of all of us. We're smarter than him. But this guy... I almost said this dummy. This guy, he left the package and the pens and everything else on my bed. So he didn't even try to hide the fact that he was taking my shirt. And so I said, Danny, come here. And I could hear the guys. They're like, I told you he was going to get, told you. And then I was like, hey, man, is that my shirt? And he says, no. I said, man, I'm going to ask you again. Because I have shirts in the closet that are Ralph Lauren. I know you don't wear it. It's too big for you right now. Is that my shirt? He goes, it was, but it's mine now. And so I'm explaining to him, I'm like, hey, you could have taken any one of my shirts. I said, but that's like my most expensive one. It was like $90 at the time. I was like, that's my most expensive one. And I really like that shirt. So I tell you what, I'm going to give you a shirt. Just take that one off. He says, no. I don't know why little bros think they can take big bros. I don't know why. Anybody got a little bro like that? They think they tough, right? And you're like, hey, I'm big brother. I don't care how big you are. I can chop you down real quick. Any big brothers? Right? That's how I am. Amen. But here's the thing. I told you pre-pastoral days. So I'm like, look, just take my shirt off. I'll give you another shirt. He's like, no, if you want it, you're going to have to take it. You ain't got to tempt me with a good time. Listen, I said, look, I will give you one more time. Take off my shirt or I will take it. And he said, all right, well, you're going to have to take it. So I go to grab my shirt and he breaks the cardinal family rule. He starts swinging. I'm like punching, like throwing punches. And if it wasn't for my Floyd Mayweather skills, I would have caught one or two of them. But I was like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Because we were taught you never fight a family member. We didn't throw punches at each other. We wrestled. And we taught each other how to fight, but we didn't fight each other. But the thing is, if you mess with one of us, you got to mess with all of us. That's the thing. We had about 8 to 10 of us that were all about the same size. We're all about boys. Well, I mean, we're not all about boys. Help us, Father. We're all about girls, but we are boys. And the thing is, we had about 8 to 10 of us. We're all the same size. You didn't mess with one of us, and you didn't see all of us. The thing is, Danny, he swung that day. And I said, oh, did you try and punch me? He was like, yeah, I told you, if you want the shirt, you're going to have to get it. So guess what I did? I said, man, all right, it is what it is. At that point, I'm running towards him. He tries to connect. I move out the way. I pick him up. I body slam him on the floor. And I, like, have my hand on his chest. And I'm, like, yelling at him to give me a shirt. At that point, all the boys come rushing in, and they take me off of him. And he gets up, and he rips my shirt. Takes it off, and he throws it at me, and he could have met Jesus that day if it hadn't been for all the other guys that were there. And later on, we had to explain to my mom why her two sons were fighting over a shirt. Bottom line, I got my shirt back. Yeah. And I didn't give him anything else that belonged to me. Here's my point with this whole story. For me, it was my little big brother who was wearing something that belonged to me that he did not pay for. But for us, the church, the enemy has been walking around with some things that he was never given permission to have that he did not pay for. And it belongs to each and every one of you. And today, subtopic, we have to tell the devil, scream it back at me, take it off. Now, look, some of y'all must want him to hold on to everything you got. I said, scream at me, take it off. You got to tell the devil, take off the authority, take off the confidence, take off your joy, take off your power, take off your peace, take off anything that belongs to you. You keep your clothes on while I'm preaching, amen? But you got to tell the devil, scream it back, take it off. Now, back in the Bible days, garments were important. Yeah, people could tell, much like today, who you were based on the garments that you wore. Kings, priests, beggars, women and men, rich or poor, and even lepers wore different types of garments. And here's the thing. A king would not let a beggar wear his robe unless the beggar was being honored for something that he did. And the Bible tells us in Revelation 1:6 that we are kings and priests in the kingdom of God. So why are we allowing the enemy to wear our stuff? Come on, I know the Bible says that he's like a lion seeking who he may devour. I'm going to show you what he looks like. And he may make himself bigger, stronger, and even throw a punch your way. But he's not a lion. He's a liar. Come on. And as children of the only living God, with the revelation that Jesus paid the price for something more valuable than a dress shirt, we ought not let the enemy have what belongs to us. Somebody shout, take it off. Church, there comes a time where you're going to have to body slam the enemy with your bold prayers, wrestle him into submission with your worship, and make him tap out with your praise and render him defeated by choosing to have a right relationship with Jesus Christ. You got to take it all back. Not only what the enemy stole, but sometimes you got to take back what you gave to him. You got to tell the devil, hey, you can't have my family. You can't have my increase. You can't have my breakthrough. You can't have my marriage. You can't have my joy. You can't have my job. Get out of my bank account. Get out of my marriage. Come on. Get out of my mind. You can't have my mental health. We've got to speak to the devil. You can't have my children. You can't have my future. It does not belong to you. You didn't pay for it. Jesus paid for it. Jesus is my kinsman redeemer. Jesus died on the cross. He's a propitiation for my sin. Jesus paid it all. You got to tell the devil, take it off. The Bible says in Ephesians 1 that you are the one who are accepted. You are the ones who are holy, loved, chosen, forgiven, adopted, redeemed, have God's good grace, his mercy, and a hope, and a future. A good life has been predestined for all of us. And we have access to the mysteries of God. And he reveals these things through us, those things that are hidden from the enemy. So again, I ask, why are you letting the devil walk around with your stuff like he's in control of your life? So here's a question. I want you to take 2 or 3 minutes with your table, just talk about it. What are some things that you feel like the enemy is trying to take control of that belongs to you? What are some things that you feel like the enemy is trying to take control of that belongs to you? Well, bless the Lord. How many of you can admit that you had at least something that you know the enemy is trying to meddle in that he shouldn't be messing with? Come on. Come on. Somebody shout, take it all. Yeah, the Bible says this. That was just my intro, by the way. The Bible says this in Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12 through 16. How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations. For you said in your heart, listen, I will ascend into the heavens. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. This is Lucifer while he's in heaven. This is him talking fake news. Come on. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation of the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. And this is what God says. Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit. Those who see you one day will gaze at you and consider you, saying, is this the man who made the earth tremble and who shook the kingdoms? How many of you know that one day we're going to look at the devil and we're going to say, it was that was driving my life? It was that little that was doing all that damage in my family, that was doing all that damage, that I gave control to that? One day we're going to look at him like that. And scholars believe that this scripture is a double reference to the pride of Satan before the fall and an earthly king, like a Babylonian king or the future Antichrist. Anyway, it's the spirit that drives those particular individuals. And as a result of sin against God, listen, Lucifer's 5 I wills were not in alignment with the Father. And Lucifer was banished from living in the presence of God. He was there. He was banished from living in the presence of God. And his name was changed from Lucifer, which means morning star, to Satan, which means adversary. And a morning star is something that you normally would get up and wake up to and not flee from or fight against. But Satan is the latter. He is something that you need to flee from and fight against. Come on. His name was changed from something that was beautiful to something that you don't even want to behold. All because some people say that it was because of his pride. But I say it was because of his vanity. And I'm going to show you that in just a few minutes. But this means, watch this, when God said that I brought you down, I'm going to throw you to the bottomless pit forever, that the enemy's future, guess what, is already predetermined. He already has a future in a place that I hope that none of you want to go. That's a whole sermon for another day. As a matter of fact, it was fasted for him from the very beginning, and I'm going to prove that to you today, because God already knew that the enemy would be full of pride, and that, get this, he would persuade a third of the angels in heaven to give up their position. I'm sorry, what'd you just say? Did y'all pick up what I just laid down? He would persuade a third of the angels who were already in heaven, where you're trying to go. They were there. They saw the streets of gold. They probably ate some manna. He was there. They were there. You know what that tells me? This ain't even on my notes, but I got to give it to somebody in the room. You know what that tells me? That tells me if the devil is in heaven and he was able to persuade a third of the angels who were in the presence of God, that means, guess what, y'all? You cannot defeat the enemy on your own. You need the Holy Spirit. Man, let me just, you need the Holy Ghost. You need the Holy Spirit. You need the power of God. Your associate's degree, bachelor's degree, master's degree, PhD does not compare to the G-O-D that he is afraid of. When you say the name of Jesus, demons tremble. Come on. He knows who God is. You can't fight him on your own. So stop trying to fight him on your own. That's why you need Jesus. Amen. And amen. I don't know who that's for, but praise God. But here's the thing. He gave up his position to try and conquer the heavens. And now he's trying to conquer the earth. And you got to remind him, listen, you got the power and authority to remind him, hey, listen up, little man. Your place in heaven, you gave that up. I didn't give it up. You gave it up. And you have a place that you need to go or that you're going to go. So you need to leave me alone because I belong to the Lord. That's the power and authority that God, that Jesus died to give you. So you can tell the devil, hey, hit the road, Jack, and don't come back. All right, y'all come on back. Y'all come on back. But you got to tell the devil, take it off. And God has fastened some things for you that the enemy, like my brother, is trying to wear. So what are those things that Satan wants to steal from you that God never intended for him to have? And the key was hidden in a place called the third row, and you'll see why in just a minute. And that was just, again, my little second intro. Are you ready for the revelation? Say yes. Here we go. Ezekiel chapter 28. It's going to be very easy. Just remember Ezekiel 28 and Exodus 28. Amen? And you'll see what I'm talking about. Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 13 through 17. It says this, and I read it in the old school King James Version, so I'm going to sound like a real preacher, and I put on a suit and stuff so I can read it like a real preacher. Thou has been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the sapphire, and the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tablets and thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou was created. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountains of God. Thou hast walked up and down amid the stones of fire. Thou was perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created, till iniquity was found in thee. And this is yet another double reference, this time to the king of Tyre and the spirit that was driving him, Satan. And we learn that this anointed angel, Lucifer, had everything. Listen to me, y'all. He had influence. He had flawless beauty. He had power. Anybody like that in the room? He had power. He had access to privileged places. He had access to the garden of God. He was in the holy mountains, a special place where the stones of fire was kept. He was in all those places. And he was special, but the problem was he was aware of it. And he knew it all so well that he forgot that what he had was a gift from God. And like I said before, many believe that it was his pride that got him kicked out of heaven, that caused his collapse. But I believe, too, that it was his vanity. I believe that he became so fascinated with his own beauty, his intellect, his power, his authority, and that he began to want the honor and glory that belonged to God for himself. Hashtag dangerous. And we see that happening in the world today, and it's even creeping into the church. And can you hear me when I say this? You never want to get to a place where you think you're so beautiful, prosperous, or influential that you forget that it's God who gave you what you got. We never want to get to that place. He became so hooked on himself that instead of thanking God as he was created to, he wanted to be worshipped. He became arrogant, and like Isaiah wrote, he arrogantly began aspiring the throne of God. His pride led to his punishment, and he was put out of the presence of God. And here it is, another nugget for you. Write this down. Your charisma never outranks your character in the eyes of God. Your gifts and talents do not matter if your heart is not right. Well, Pastor, I'm sorry, then why is it that all these people on the earth are prospering and they're making all the money and they got all the cars and they're driving this nice little ugly truck that Elon Musk came up with, and everybody's doing this and everybody's got that. But guess what? At the end of the day, if their heart is not with God, their eternal fate has been sealed. And that's what matters. Set your sights on things that are eternal. And so to experience all that God has for you, there must be an alignment of your will to the will of the Father. And Lucifer and his five I wills did not line up. And God already knew this, and we'll see how he handled it. Yep. In verse 13, we learn that Lucifer's clothing was covered with precious stones that were given to him on the day he was created. Sardis, topaz, diamond, beryl, onyx, jasper, sapphire, emerald, and carbuncle. 9 stones that were on Lucifer's covering. Watch this. We're going to fast forward real quick to the breastplate of the high priest that God told Moses to have make. We're going to take a jump. From Lucifer now, we're going to talk about the good guys. Amen? So watch this. Remember I said that garments were important? The breastplate of righteousness that the priest wore symbolized the right standing with God. Yeah. And when you receive Christ into your life, the Bible says that he became your righteousness. And so the breastplate of righteousness has the name of Jesus all over it. It's like he was declaring that your self-righteousness isn't enough to protect you from the judgment of God. So he had to give you his own. The Bible says he is our righteousness, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30. And the Bible says that he is our high priest, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 through 16. And we are now considered a kingdom of priests that serve the Lord. I'm going to give you a little bit of school, and then we're going to get excited, and y'all going to go get some Chick-fil-A. I'm sorry, it's closed, so y'all can hang out with me for the rest of the day. Listen, but it was all paid for by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And God also gave the high priest access to the privileged places. Can we show the picture of the tabernacle? I won't go into too much, but they were to go into the deep parts, the holy of holies, on behalf of the people once a year, and offer sacrifices for the sins of the people. So the high priest, because of the garments that they wore, that's what separated them and gave them the authority to walk into the holies of holies and make atonement for the people on an annual basis. So the high priest had special garments that were required, amen, to gain access to the inner court, which represented his authority as mediator between God and the people. So let's show a picture of the high priest so they can see what that looks like with those stones. Now, rabbis teach that the garments they wore were for honor and beauty before the Lord, and that sounds a whole lot like what Lucifer was supposed to be. And remember I said that the mysteries of God are often revealed in patterns. Yes? So the high priest, watch this, going into the most holy place was a pattern of what Jesus, our high priest, did for us when he sacrificed one time his blood for our sins. And you'll read about that in Hebrews chapter 9. And he made us right with God. And I mention that because Jesus is our high priest. Giving him access to privileged places, and he is God, right? And if he lives in us, listen, when we make him our Lord and Savior, then we have access to the privileged places. The veil was torn when the blood was shed. Did you pick up what I just laid down? I said the veil was torn when the blood was shed. So you can go boldly before the throne of God. You got access to privileged places. And the Bible says that we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. So spiritually, listen to me, we put on righteousness and have access to the things of God. So can you just take a moment, put your hands together for Jesus, our high priest, and him giving you access to the high place, to the secret places? So Lucifer had access and gave it up. And he's trying to get you to do the same thing. And I leave you again with another nugget. Do not give up your right standing with God. Look at somebody at your table and tell them, hey, do not give up your right standing with God. No matter what happens in the world, no matter what you see on the news, no matter who gets elected. Okay, let's come on back. Amen. Do not give up your right standing with God. Don't let anything get in the way of your relationship with Jesus Christ. So, Scooby-Doo, are you ready for the revelation? Are you ready for the mystery? Say yes. Okay, so Lucifer had 9 stones on his covering, but the breastplate of the high priest had 12 stones. 12 minus 9 is 3. So there were 3 stones that the enemy was missing. What were the 3 stones that the enemy was missing, and what did they mean for the people of God? Don't look at your papers. Cheater, cheater, pumpkin eater. Don't look. Go to Exodus 28. Exodus 28. We're going to try and speed through this real quick so y'all can run and shout and say amen. Amen. Exodus 28, 15 through 21. And this is what it says in the New Living Translation. And then I'll go ahead and throw in some King James Version and we'll get you out of here. It says, then with great skill and care, make a chest piece, talking about for the priest, a breastplate to be worn for seeking the decision from God, and make it to match the ephod, the breastplate of righteousness, using finely woven linen embroidered with gold and with blue and purple and scarlet thread. Make a chest piece of a single piece of cloth folded to form a pouch 9 inches square, and mount, listen, 4 rows of gemstones on it. 4 rows of gemstones on it. Each given a name from the tribe of Israel. The first row will contain a red carnelian, a pale green peridot, an emerald. I'm going to give you the other version so you can see what he's talking about. The second row will contain a turquoise, a blue lapis lazuli, and a white moonstone. The third row will contain an orange jacinth, an agate, and a purple amethyst. The fourth row will contain a blue green beryl, an onyx, and a green jasper. All these stones will be set in gold filigree. Each stone will represent one of the 12 of the sons of Israel, and the name of that tribe will be engraved on it like a seal. So the stones of the high priest were sardius, topaz, carbuncle, emerald, sapphire, diamond, ligure, agate, amethyst, beryl, onyx, and jasper. 12 stones. And remember, Lucifer had 9 stones, and the high priest had how many? So what were the 3 stones that God did not give to Lucifer that he gave to the high priest, that he gave to Jesus Christ, that he gave to us who have Jesus Christ living on the inside of us? Okay, we're out of time. And I'm doing part B next week, so let me pray for y'all. Nah, I kid. I'm going to give it to you right now. But first, let me explain. Each stone on the breastplate of the high priest had a name and a meaning that were placed in specific order based on the names of the tribes of Israel or the sons of Jacob. So each name, watch this, gives a revelation to all of us that points out to what God originally intended for his people. As a matter of fact, when you take all the names on the breastplate and you put them together with their meanings, this is what you're going to get. It's going to point to Jesus, but when you take all the names I'm going to show you and you put them together, this is what you get. Listen to this. Behold, a son is born to us, one who hears us and covenants to be with us. Praise the Lord. He judged our struggle and still brought us good fortune. Happiness, reward, and honor is what he added to his family and called us the sons of righteousness. When you take all 12 names and you read them together, that's what it says. It all points to Jesus. And that's been made available through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ to every single one of us. Isn't that amazing? Y'all want me to say it again in English? Because y'all act like y'all just heard some some Greek or Hebrew. Behold, a son is born to us, one who hears and covenants to be with us. I'm talking about Jesus, Emmanuel. Praise the Lord. He judged our struggle and still brought us good fortune, regardless of how jacked up we were. Happiness, reward, and honor is what he added to his family. Are y'all God's family? Say yes. And he called us the sons of righteousness. So wait, there's more. Three things that God did not give the enemy that he gave to you. So real quick, can I get 12 volunteers? I need 12 volunteers, and we're going to wrap up. Give me 12 volunteers. And don't everybody move at the same time. 12 people. The blessings of the Lord makes you rich and adds no sorrow to it. I'm going to need your help, Deacon Will. So can you pass these out, and then you know what to do with the other three? So they can show those, and then the other three they can show. So 12 guys, just line up this way. Give me 6 on this side, and give me 6 on this side. So who we got? What's up, little man? Give me a pound, man. Come on. Thank you. All right, how many we have on this side? We got 6 on this side? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Can we get one more on this side? Come on, I need 12 people. 12 people. All right, so I got 6 right here. Do I have 6 over here? 1, 2, 3, 4. Come on, give me 2 more. There we go, right there. The fashion model. Yeah, come on, man. Yeah. I knew he was going to come up. Like, bless his man. I got to know your name. So listen, go ahead and hand them out. 12 tribes of Israel. So hold on. The first one should be, I tell you what, this is what we're going to do, because we're doing from left to right, but in Hebrew, they read from right to left. So start on this side, and we'll hand them out. You'll see what we're talking about. So the first one, the first child that Jacob had was Reuben. You can show yours, Reuben. Just turn yours around. And Reuben and Simeon and Levi and Judah and Dan and Naphtali. And then you, sir, you're going to, hold on, let me make sure yours. Naphtali, okay. And then you three guys, the next three guys, you're not going to show yours. And then after that, don't show yours. After that, you've got Zebulun, you can show yours, and Joseph and Benjamin. Right? So you guys show yours. So we have Reuben, Sardius, Simeon, Topaz, Levi, Carbuncle, Judah, Emerald, Dan, Sapphire, Naphtali, Diamond. You've got three guys. You don't know what those three stones are. And then you got Zebulun, which is the beryl, Joseph, which is the onyx, and Benjamin, which is the jasper. Every one of those sons have a name that means something. Reuben, the word that's synonymous with his name is, I believe the name says, I see a son, right? Or behold a son. So the synonym that goes with that is vision. Simeon means God hears, right? So the synonym that goes with that is hearing. With Levi, it's covenant. With Judah means praise. And Dan means discipline or judgment. And Naphtali means wrestling. And then we've got three guys here. I'm going to tell you what they are in a minute. But Zebulun means dwelling. Hold yours up, Zebulun, little man. Hold yours up. Zebulun means dwelling, right? Joseph means increase. And Benjamin means dominion. So the 9 people that are showing you what they have, Lucifer was covered with all that. He had access to all of that when he was in the heavens. And all of that is what he was supposed to be for God. But he lost sight of it all, and he decided that he wanted to be God. And so he lost all of that. He lost all of that. He lost vision, he lost hearing, he lost covenant, he lost praise, he lost, well, he gained some judgment. I'm going to tell you what he did gain. he lost his dwelling, he lost increase, and he lost dominion. But there were 3 things that God gave us that he didn't give Lucifer. He already predestined it for you to have it, because he knew that Lucifer was going to turn against him and that he'd become Satan, and he'd try and deceive the world in the time that we're living in today. So God has given you some things to fight against the enemy in the times we're living in today. Y'all ought to shout hallelujah. What are they? The first one, right here, what's your name?
Joshua.
That's a nice name. The first one that God gave you, his says the Lagur, Gad, is the tribe. The first thing that God gave you that he didn't intend for the enemy to have is victory. Victory. Gad means a troop is coming. And this tribe was to lead Israel. Listen, lead Israel into victory when they got to the promised land. They were men of victory where one of their weakest could defeat 100 and their strongest could defeat 1,000, like Joshua, like they probably were built like him and looked like him. Come on. And here's what I'm here to tell you today. Because you have victory, guess what? You are the biggest winner, and the devil is the biggest, thank you, Reverend, I forget his name, Lehuzer. Reverend Ace Ventura. Another way to look at a troop is coming is watch this. Help is on the way. So you've got to know, I preached a message one time called Lord Help, that when you get in trouble, you say, Lord Help. And help is on the way. You have victory. You're more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ. All you've got to do is stop praying for it. Just pray from a place of victory. You already have it. It's already been predetermined. It's already destined for you. You need to worship from a place of victory. Come on. The Ligur stone, it was like a bluest looking stone, and blue represents the heavenlies. And Satan, guess what? He doesn't have free access to the heavenlies like you do. He doesn't have free access like he once had. And I was going to say, you know, wearing victory is like putting on a Dallas Cowboy jersey, but I'm not going to lie to you today. But you got to know that because you have victory, you're going to win at some point. It may not look like you're winning right now in the middle of the struggle, but you got to know that with God, all things are possible, and that you are more than a conqueror, that you will win. And even if you don't on the earth, the back of the book says, when you get before his presence, you'll hear him say, well done, my good and faithful servant. And guess what that means? You win. So you got to know that you're going to win. God would not allow Satan to wear your victory. Victory was fashioned for you, and it doesn't even fit the devil. Come on. Come on, tell somebody around you, you got the victory. Look at somebody who look like they lose, and just tell them, you got the victory. Come on. I didn't say look at them like they a loser. I said look at them like they need some victory. Come on. So you got victory. What's the second thing? Go ahead, turn around, man. Yeah, the second thing that God gave you, he didn't give the enemy. He gave you victory, and then he gave you blessings. Asher's name means happy. That's what it means when you're blessed. That means that you know wherever I am, wherever I go, I'm blessed. I'm happy. I can be happy because I know God's got my back. The blessings of the Lord makes me rich, and he adds no sorrow to it. You know what that means? He adds no sorrow. That means that even though it's hard, it's going to get easier. Even though it's heavy, it's going to get lighter. Even though it hurts, one day it's not going to hurt. Praise God. You have the blessings of God, and you can expect God's best in your life. You can expect God to be generous to you every day. You were meant to live happily ever after on the earth. Here's the thing about the Asherites. They were faithful and they were generous, just like we're supposed to be. They supplied Israel with enough anointing oil, enough oil to represent the blessing and anointing of God. And they gave them so much that Israel could create its own wealth. You have the anointing and the blessing of God on your life to not only be satisfied with your life, but to also bless somebody else. You just got to start walking in the victory and accept the blessings that God has for you. Well, Pastor, you don't understand it. It's so hard right now. If you change the way you think and you change the way you talk, I'm telling you, God will have you. Amos 9 says, blessings upon blessings that you don't have room enough to receive. Deuteronomy 28 says, you're blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed when you go out, blessed when you come in, blessed on your job, blessed in your home, blessed at the school. Your children are blessed. Your mama's blessed. Your daddy's blessed. Everybody that you're connecting with is blessed. Why? Because you are in connection with them. You are blessed. Agate stone is a red stone. And red is synonymous with the blood. Y'all, hold on. I feel the Holy Spirit right now. You're blessed because of the blood. My God. You have every spiritual blessing, it says in Ephesians chapter 1. And every earthly blessing, it says in Deuteronomy 28. You are blessed, hallelujah, as it says in Amos 9. Why? Because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ.
You got to live. You got to pray. You got to worship. And you got to give like you know you're blessed. And what's the last thing? Yeah, somebody shout, I'm blessed. My. You got victory. Come on. I don't know who it is in this room that's been going through it. You've been having a hard time. But I just want to tell you that you've got victory. That you've got victory. Come on. You've got victory. You've got victory. You ought to hold your hands up like the champions do when they get a gold medal. Come on. You already got a gold medal and you ain't even started the race yet. You already got a trophy and you ain't even gotten the game yet. You already. Come on. What's the last thing that they gave you? God gave you. Go ahead, man. Yeah. Issachar. His name means reward. It's synonymous with, watch this, inheritance. You've got something the devil will never have. You are in covenant with God. And that sons and daughters of Abraham, you have the favor of God in your life. Their possessions, listen to me, their possessions and property that's waiting on you in heaven, yep, and on earth. There's a mansion waiting for you that Jesus is preparing. Come on. And you've got property on the earth. Come on. You've got some territory that you've got to take in the earth. It belongs to you. You have an inheritance. Now is the time and season to go get your inheritance. Here's the thing about inheritance. An inheritance is something that you receive after the death of someone who previously held it. When Jesus died, that released your inheritance. When he shed his blood for you, that released your inheritance. When he sent the Holy Spirit to dwell inside of you, that gave you the power and authority to go. And it basically, you know what that is? When he filled you with his spirit, guess what? That was your identifier that says, hey, I got inheritance. He's the engagement ring, the Bible says, that makes you the bride of Christ. The Holy Spirit is your inheritance. Come on. The children of Issachar understood the times and seasons that they were in, and they knew what need to be done. And can I just prophesy over this body, amen, that in the times we're living in, that we all as children of God will have the understanding and know what to do regardless of what's happening in the world that we're living in, that God's going to take care of his people. How many of you believe that? That no matter what happens in the economy, no matter how bad it says the Dow's going to get, no matter how bad, how high gas is going to run up, you got to know that God's going to provide for you. It doesn't matter who empties the shelves at Walmart. You got to know that God's going to provide for you. If he can make water come out of a rock, he can do anything. If he can make quail come from heaven, Chick-fil-A out of the heavens, hallelujah, that he can do anything. If he can make manna rain from the sky, don't you think God can give you a slice of bread? My God in heaven. Whew. Lucifer was created with limitations, but you've got access to the Lord who's limitless. And Satan has a reward, yep, for his foolishness. And you've got an inheritance for your faithfulness. It says in Genesis 49:14 that Issachar is a strong donkey crouching between two burdens. Here it is. Satan, he can't bear no burdens. He's too wimpy. But with God, listen, tell somebody in your table, you can handle it. You can handle it. Come on. Because you got blessings, because you got inheritance, because you got victory, you can handle it. Whatever it is that you're going through, you don't have to quit. You don't have to throw in the towel. You don't have to turn around. You don't have to give up. I don't know who this is for, but you don't have to get divorced. You know you love that lady. You know you love that man. So you don't have to give it up. All you got to do is put them before the Lord. Amen. Throw some oil on their pillow. I don't know who this is for, but throw some oil on their pillow. Throw some oil on your door. Throw some oil in their food. Amen. And pray and watch God turn things around in your favor. I'm looking right at you. God's going to turn it around, and you're going to share a testimony of how good God is. You've got inheritance. So don't give up your inheritance. When Jesus died and got up from the grave, it secured your inheritance to have eternal life with God. And that life included limitless benefits. Because here's the thing about the amethyst. It's a purple stone. I got to go. And it's often associated with royalty. And you are kings and priests. And so the inheritance belongs to you and not the devil. Somebody shout if you're excited. Take it off. Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to land this plane. I'm going to put my car in the garage. I'm about to go ahead and end this thing right now. Watch this. The enemy was never meant to have victory, blessings, or inheritance. These things were reserved for you by God. And that's why he's worthy of your worship. That's why every time you come in this place, the worship team shouldn't have to say, lift your hands, hallelujah, leap for joy, hallelujah, jump and shout, hallelujah, say something, hallelujah. Like, they shouldn't have to do that. You should come in knowing, guess what? God gave me victory this week. God blessed me this week. I know I have an inheritance with God. So as soon as you come in, you ought to enter his gates with thanksgiving. I feel the Holy Ghost. And into his courts with praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Should be your shout because you know God has blessed you. He would not allow the enemy to wear anything that belonged to you. So you got to tell the devil, take off the victory, take off the blessings, take off the inheritance. You can't have my family. You can't have my finances. You can't have my fitness. You can't have my future. Here it is. Satan wants you to think that it's his. He even tried to tempt Jesus in Matthew chapter 4, verse 1 through 11. I'm closing. And he says this, turn the stones to bread and get your blessings, Jesus. Throw yourself off the mountain and watch the angels come and rescue you and give you victory, Jesus. And what did Jesus say? Boy, get away from me. That's what you need to say. It's written. It's written. And Satan continued. He didn't get the hint. He says, I'll give you everything in the whole world as an inheritance, Jesus. And Jesus is like, wait a minute, it all belongs to me anyway. It's written. That's what you got to tell the devil. You got to tell the devil when he's trying to get you addicted to, I don't know who this is in the room, but you got to get over that addiction because you don't need it. Because guess what? Victory's already yours. You don't need to take a puff, puff, give in order for you to have victory. You don't need to overconsume on the drink in order for you to have victory. You just got to tell the devil, it's written, it belongs to me. You can even remind him of what his destiny is, that it's already been determined. And here's a free bonus. Here's a free bonus. You ready for it? If you take the third row and apply it to the jewels that were mentioned on Lucifer's covering, watch this. Those three jewels that were mentioned on Lucifer's covering, I want you to step forward if you have this one. Those three jewels were praise, discipline. That's to be you. Well done. Yeah, you. And then covenant. Watch this. Because I was reading this, and I was like, oh, God, this is incredible. I'm talking about this is the destiny of the devil. Watch this. God says this. You'll learn. The first one you have here is Judah. It means praise. He had that when he should have been doing that when he was in heaven. That's what he was created for. Right? Sapphire, he was there. He had a covenant when he was there with God as Lucifer. But here's what you'll learn. Because he decided to give it all up. Watch the statement. He was created to praise the Lord. But because he wanted it for himself and did not have the discipline to stay humble before the Lord, the judgment against him is final. And he will not take part in the new covenant. That's what's fashioned for him. God already knew that he was going to turn against him. And he says, I can't give you victory. I can't give you an inheritance. And I can't give you blessings. But I'm going to equip my people who you are going to go after. And they're going to have some stuff that you ain't going to even know. And when you try and come up against them, they're going to say, look at the hand. I got victory. I'm sorry. Look at the hand. I got victory. Yeah, yeah, yeah. As a matter of fact, they're going to raise both hands. Look at these hands. We got victory. Come on. Look at my knees. They're wearing out. I got blessings. I'm on them all day, thanking God every day because he's blessed me exceedingly, abundantly, above what I could ask or imagine. And I have an inheritance. And you can't wear any of it. It was not fashioned for you, but it was predestined for the people of God. And it's always been there for us to see. Guess what? All three of those stones are on the third row. They're all on the third row. They've all always been there for us to see. You've got victory. You've got blessings. You've got inheritance. Somebody tell the devil, take it off. So listen, before we leave today, I never go without giving anybody the opportunity to give Jesus Christ access to their lives, making him their Lord and Savior. If you're here today and you have not said, Lord, will you forgive my sins? I want you to be Lord of my life. I want you to be my Savior. You can have victory, blessings, and inheritance. If you don't feel like, thank you guys. Let's give it up for these guys. With Jesus Christ, he's your inheritance. It says in Romans chapter 1, verse 11, that he gave us, he predestined us through Christ to have an inheritance. That's what God did for you. So if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, or if you don't have a right relationship with Jesus, or watch this, if you at some point you had a relationship with Jesus and you turned your back on him and you started going the other way, but you want to make it right today, your heart got to be in the right place. You are his righteousness, and today he's giving you an opportunity to do so. All I want you to do, if this is okay, is just raise your hand so we can see who you are. Just as a sign of faith. If you say, you know what? I'm not saved and I want to be saved. There's one. Hallelujah. Thank God. Hallelujah. Come on. Angels are rejoicing. Praise God for the little girl right here. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Is there anybody else who says, I want a right relationship with Jesus Christ? If you're here today, if you're watching online and you say, hey, Pastor, me, I want to have a right relationship with Jesus Christ. This is what we're going to do today. With every eye open and every head lifted. You want to know why I do that? I do that simply because if you can't accept Jesus in a room full of Christians, you won't be able to defend him in a room full of sinners. So can we pray as a family today? Amen. Amen. If you want Jesus in your heart as Lord and Savior, it's not about the prayer, but it's about your heart. And it's about what you believe according to Romans 10 and 9. Repeat this after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you died on the cross for me, and I believe you rose from the grave for me, and you're coming back for me. I ask you to forgive me of all my sins. I want you to be my Lord and Savior. Take my life and do your will. And Lord, I thank you that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm saved. I'm set free. I've got victory, I've got blessings, I've got inheritance. In Jesus' name. Now come on, give God a shout. Come on, give God a shout.